the movie industry have looked like if Hollywood had embraced diversity during its golden age?
Roll cameras! Dreamland, scene four, take one!
Hollywood on Netflix rewrites the scenery of post-World War II Tinseltown, reimagining the entertainment business through a more progressive lens. Essentially, the show sets about rewriting some of the wrongs of Hollywood history. Here are some of the true stories behind Hollywood, and how the show attempts to reframe them. Strictly speaking, Peg Entwistle herself is not a character in Hollywood, but her story is important, and one which is rewritten by the leading players of the show as the season progresses.
How does a black man end up writing a picture about a white girl who jumps off the Hollywood sign?
When I think of Peg Entwistle, I see myself. I understand her rage.
She was a British actress who tragically became known for her death after she jumped from the H of the Hollywood sign. Entwistle appeared in several Broadway productions and one film, 13 Women, which was released after she died. Her story is the one screenwriter Archie Coleman uses to get his break with Ace Studios.
So writing her story, I feel like I'm telling her, Peg, somebody's finally gonna break you into this business. You and me both.
It's eventually rewritten as Meg when Camille Washington is given the leading role. But we see too how the creators of Meg attempt to craft a more hopeful ending for Entwistle through their film, in the same way the creators of the show have written a more hopeful Hollywood.
What if she climbs back down, she takes her boyfriend's hand, I mean, we know she's gone to the brink, but she survived it. She gonna be all right. That's a very different movie.
In the second episode, we're introduced to Anna May Wong, considered to be the first Chinese-American Hollywood movie star.
This town will never give that to someone like me.
The TV series shows how she was passed over for the leading role of a Chinese character in The Good Earth. The role was given to a white actress instead.
The best screen test I'd ever seen. Anna May was the only Asian movie star in town, and here, finally, was a role she could shine in. I was the one who had to tell her we were giving the role to Louise.
This part of Wong's story is true to life, and she was often frustrated during her career, which began with silent films, about the stereotypical Asian roles she was given. In 1933, she told First Weekly she felt there were few roles for her as a Chinese actress in Hollywood, even if the characters were meant to be Chinese.
My entire career. Oversexed, opium-addled courtesans, dangerously exotic Far Eastern temptresses. That's what they wanted to see from someone who looks like me.
One of her most famous roles was alongside Marlene Dietrich in Shanghai Express in 1932.
I must confess I don't quite know the standard of respectability that you demand in your boarding house, Mrs. Haggerty.
Wong often played roles which typified the dragon lady trope, which depicts an Asian woman as powerful yet mysterious and untrustworthy, and often hypersexualized. The term itself comes from a villain in a 1930s series of comics, but some historians believe the name may have been inspired by Wong's role in Daughter of the Dragon. Her characters were often written tragic, self-sacrificing death scenes. So much so, Wong commented they could write, "She died a thousand deaths" on her gravestone. In the 1950s, she became the first Asian American star to have a leading role on television, in the gallery of Madame Lu Tsong, where she played a detective who ran a global empire of art galleries. As entertaining as it sounds, no copies of the show or scripts are known to exist. Her legacy is that of a star who paved the way for Asian actors in both Hollywood and Europe, but one that wasn't truly appreciated until long after her death. The show attempts to change that, giving her an award-winning supporting role in a film which doesn't turn her into a stereotype. We first meet Rock Hudson in the show as shy, aspiring actor Roy Fitzgerald when he meets his future boyfriend at Ernie's gas station. When he's signed by terrifying agent Henry Wilson, he gets a new name.
Rock Hudson.
Rock Hudson?
Yeah. Rock Hudson's a movie star.
Now, if you're familiar with your Hollywood history, you'll recognize that name immediately. Rock Hudson was one of the most popular actors of his time. His on-screen career spanned more than four decades. Hudson first became famous as one of the heartthrobs of Hollywood's golden age of cinema, and went on to become a major television star in his later career. As one of Hollywood's leading men, his public image was built around how attractive he was to women. But as we know from the show, he was gay, something the public wasn't aware of until he died from AIDS-related complications in 1985. Throughout his life, Hudson faced blackmailing attempts threatening to reveal his sexuality. But in the show, a young Hudson, played by Jake Picking, decides he wants to be open about his sexuality, walking hand in hand with Archie at the Oscars. His career suffers.
I think folks knowing I'm queer, that just means there's only so many parts I can play, you know?
But it leads to a role in a film which depicts his and Archie's love story, a first for old Hollywood.
I'd like to go to Dreamland.
I'll take you there.
The real-life story of gay men in Hollywood is very different. A small number of closeted LGBT men have won acting Oscars, but only one openly gay man has ever picked up the statue for acting, when John Gielgud won for Best Supporting Actor in 1981.
I know in the first 30 seconds if somebody's got what it takes to be a star.
The man behind Hudson's name and stardom is played by Jim Parsons. Henry Wilson is a powerful agent who boasts of creating Lana Turner's career, among others.
You treat me with the respect I deserve, because I am not just a star, I am a star maker.
But that star making comes alongside the sexual abuse of his clients.
I need to suck your cock.
Excuse me?
It's my thing.
The real-life Wilson was indeed a powerful agent, known for the attractive men on his client base, his most famous being Rock Hudson. According to historians and biographers, he was known for coercing his stars into sexual relationships. He was also instrumental in keeping Hudson's sexuality from the public. In 1955, he swapped information about his other clients to stop a magazine from publishing an exposé about Hudson. He reportedly urged his client to marry his secretary, Phyllis Gates, to put any rumours to rest.
How is this my fucking life, Phyllis?
While the show doesn't flinch from the underlying abusiveness to Wilson's tutelage, it gives the star agent the opportunity to apologise for and contextualise his actions.
Look, point is, I am here to say I'm sorry for what I did to you.
Though it does not give him the forgiveness his character seeks from Hudson.
I still have nightmares about you, Henry.
Okay.
Okay.
Two actors from Gone with the Wind appear in the show. Vivian Leigh makes a few appearances, but Hattie McDaniel, played by Queen Latifah, has a big impact on the story late in the season. McDaniel became the first black Oscar winner in 1939 for playing Mammy in Gone with the Wind.
I was the daughter of two slaves, and here I was, with an Academy Award. I only played that role because my grandmother worked on a plantation, and I knew who that woman was. I knew Mammy.
It was a bittersweet win. The hotel the Oscars were held in was segregated, and she was sat at a table at the furthest end of the room, rather than front and center with the rest of the cast. Like Anna May Wong, she too found herself typecast, and Gone with the Wind wasn't the only film in which she played a maid.
You know, I thought winning was gonna change things for me. No more goddamn maids. Maybe I get to play somebody romantic or comedy part, you know, some funny rich lady in New York with a feather in her cap. But fucking no. The roles never came.
Hollywood doesn't rewrite McDaniel's story as such, but it does allow her to mentor Camille, a young black actress who, in the show's world, ends up being nominated for an Oscar for her leading role in Meg. Because of the advice McDaniel's character gives her,
when you go to that ceremony, you sit right down in that front row.
She ensures she's in the room, sitting with the rest of the cast and crew of the movie when her name is called as the winner.
I don't know what you've been told, but I'm going to count to three and then I'm going to walk into that ceremony and take my seat in the front row.
In the real world, it was 51 years after Hattie McDaniel won before another black actress picked up an Oscar when Whoopi Goldberg won for Ghost in 1990. Furthermore, while in the show we see Camille win Best Actress, in reality only one black woman has won Leading Actress, which was Halle Berry. That didn't happen until 2001. These aren't the only famous faces from the era you'll see in Hollywood. There's First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt, who makes a plea to cast Camille as the lead in Meg. As mentioned before, we get snippets of Vivian Leigh.
So I take it you're in Gone with the Wind?
Yes.
Are you
yes.
Fucking kidding? She's goddamn Scarlett O'Hara, you fucking hayseed.
Oh, Henry, it's all right.
In one episode, one of director George Cukor's infamous parties is brought to life, where actress Tallulah Bankhead also makes an appearance. And to see how all these stories play out on screen, watch Hollywood, now streaming on Netflix.